Welcome to the third DVD for the first season of Happy Tree Friends TV. This is David Ichioka, your humble producer, sitting here with...
Ken Navarro, your humble director and creator, and sitting here with...
Ken Pontak, almost too humble to even introduce myself, story editor and writer of many of these episodes.
Now, it's too bad that introduction that we just did kept us from keeping... us from talking about the cool opening of this segment.
Yeah. Oh, well.
So this is, what is this called?
Change of heart.
Change of heart.
How soon we forget.
I don't know where we are. Where just directed it. Yeah. So, actually, when we were, for some weird reason, we did the Ipso Fatso episode, and then, from then on, Disco Bear became the poster boy for like bad eating habits and having an overweight problem, and we thought that was just hilarious.
And hopefully you will too. For instance, this gag we love.
Originally
the bone was stuck in the middle of the butter instead of the end, and I've never done it that way. I don't even think it would work.
Well, as an extension of his bad eating habits, of course, now he's a poster boy for heart disease as well.
We like to give a little something back, a little lesson to be learned.
I like, this is one of my favorite episodes, actually, that we've done.
Yeah, it's pretty funny.
It just all came together. The sandwich is great, that always cracks me up. Lumpy and his stupid sandwich about this whole thing. Old school beeper, good times.
And just the fact that Lumpy would be a doctor. Once again, where does he get these jobs? Who interviews him?
Well, we always cast the worst person we can think of, worst character for the jobs. And I think Lumpy pretty much fits the bill for any job.
See, he forgot to use the anesthetic.
There we go.
But he corrected his mistake.
That was a Ted Pratt joke who did the storyboards for this classic hammer in the head gag. Because Disco was still conscious.
Yes, he was. The stick of butter.
The butter. Call back.
And nice little fart sound there.
By Jim Lively.
Jim Lively. I think that fart sound actually came out of his butt.
It might have. Yeah. It's the kind of sound designer he is.
Yeah, he likes to really foley the farts. He doesn't like to go into the library for that.
He'll take one for the team that way. I like that they keep all the parts in a refrigerator, by the way.
Without even the back of the saran wrap.
Ooh, we've got to see if it's good.
Oh, it's still
good. I like that sandwich.
Don't!
The heart phone.
Exactly.
So, we wanted Lumpy to come to the scene of just some crazy accident, and we decided, what if a plane had crashed into a whale and left Handy with his heart open? So that's what we had.
Yeah, it's just this crazy random, like, gag that we don't even explain.
However,
we talked about doing an episode that would explain that later.
That's right. As a matter of fact, remember I was always trying to work that whale into other episodes.
Stay tuned for season 3.
Fans, if you can write in, if we get enough signatures, maybe
petition.
Ken. I think it's a petition to show that whale on the plane crashing.
Putting in a dollar in every letter won't hurt either.
It won't hurt at all. Stupid Lumpy.
Great little sequence with the soccer. Oh.
And another thing that was interesting is at this point of the show, we didn't have what really I think is the best gag in the whole show. That's coming up, and I'll let you know about it when we see it.
What?
Yeah, let me know about
Way
it.
Way to be cryptic.
Well, it's like, got everybody on the edge of their seat.
The lost commentary or something.
It's this. This image, which Ken drew on the board, drove the whole rest of the show.
That's true.
And we got halfway through writing the show without even thinking that we were going to use a giant whale heart.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Strapping it on his back was pretty funny, and the seagulls following him.
We just laughed forever.
It was pretty funny. Lumpy trying to push the heart out, not realizing the truck's coming in from the other side. Oh, Lumpy.
And the bicycle pays off, finally.
It's really for this shot, too. And of course the deli, because meat is funny.
Yeah, unrefrigerated meat on plates and windows. It's the the way I like to buy it.
I love the ambience of the inside that the deli.
Yes.
The music.
Mm-hmm.
Beautifully composed by Jerome.
Jerome Rawson.
Rawson.
Our intrepid composer.
That means brave.
He's unstoppable.
And brave.
And brave.
If you see him in the street, try to stop him. Won't work.
No, it's
he's
true.
He's like Juggernaut, man.
He's too brave to stop.
Don't!
Nope!
Hey, Dave, didn't you mention that there were some, like, flat lines that we had to, or the heart monitors that we had to
Yeah, we kind of forgot to put those lines in after this.
And, some scenes.
We had, like, the total final thing, and it's like, I think we should add these heart
hey,
lines in again.
We forgot to put the monitor.
I thought, I'll do it myself. This is going to be easy. It wasn't easy.
Like, of course.
Like right there. That was the shot.
It never is easy.
Yeah, you see how Lumpy's antler goes in front of it in that shot? All very difficult.
Well, but, you used a goofball inappropriate program, right?
Well, yeah, but
a
you know.
A program called Flash?
Should have used Flash.
Dirty Here's heart's been heart. Around.
Yeah, it's been around the world.
The Katamari heart. And we had to redraw this from the original one because it wasn't clear that Lumpy had put the whale heart in him.
And that's kind of the whole punchline.
Whole joke.
Boy, that heartbeat sounds good with these headphones on. Kids, watch Happy Tree Friends with headphones on.
Or surround sound, even better.
Poor Disco.
Here's a great little gag, too.
But when he has to struggle...
You get the last bite!
One more bite.
He loves his sandwiches.
Hey, did we spell absence right?
I hope so.
Absence. I love that episode. I heart that episode. You
yeah, it's a great one.
A whole lot of love. This was written by Mark Zaslav, wasn't it? Oh, no, it was not.
No, but it was storyboarded by Lippy.
Yes.
He did an amazing all-flash storyboard.
Who, if you guys don't know, Lippy is also the voice of Nettie. Multi-talented, multitasking.
Lippy is the closest thing to a living human cartoon
it's true.
Ever seen.
It's true.
More tune than human, I think, really.
Well, this idea we had for a long time.
Oh my gosh, yes.
We always wanted to do a stuck in the well story, you know, a kid stuck in a well, but we could never really figure it out. And we had that great, we also wanted to do that driller.
Yeah.
Do so like a Journey to the Center of the Earth type of machinery.
So when Cub was first created, did you realize the utility of that little hat? I mean, because it's the universal symbol of no Cub.
Well, our running joke now is that that's how Pop knows Cub. You know, if he doesn't see the hat, it's how he identifies Cub.
Yeah, because
Cub is basically the hat.
Right. Whatever has a hat on is Cub.
Is Cub. Absolutely.
You'll see that in an. I don't know if it's on this DVD. It probably is on the Every Little Bit Hurts. Is that on this DVD?
Yeah, I believe it is.
And you'll see that, yeah, when he pulls up Cub's, you know, destroyed guts, he doesn't recognize it. But then he pulls up his hat, and that's when he starts freaking out.
When the hat is on the concrete stomach and concrete solution. It's Cub.
Yeah, he
and
takes
Bob's
it home.
Happy. He takes it home and buys it sugar.
Now, see, and here Lumpy is eating, but it's not a sandwich, very strangely.
He's still eating, though. And cans of beans, because beans are funny.
And good for your heart.
The more you eat,
well, we'll see.
The more full you get. Isn't that how that limerick goes?
Something like that.
You know, this is an episode I've never seen completed until right now.
In your eyes.
It hurts.
Actually, we only got half way through. You're not going to see it completed this time either.
I could die before it's over.
You could.
Oh. That would be awesome commentary.
<You could>. That would be a first.
And a last for me.
And a last.
Don't do that. That would make me sad.
As long as it's funny. Here's them plunging down.
Yeah, I love the design of that thing.
Very complicated piece of machinery.
I like the fact that it's just bad design.
I always thought that was great. In those old designs, they would always have that bubble on top, and it's like, that would never work. It's just like, what?
Well, see, he was no good anyway.
That just looks like Lippy drew it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's awesome.
It's pretty much Lippy's drawings, Lippy's layouts.
Yeah.
See, this gag is for those people who watch and can actually understand what the Happy Tree Friends are saying.
Are we going to subtitle these?
Exactly. Kind of. If you have closed captioning on channel 52, you can actually see what they're saying.
Try it, kids.
Actually, there's a really funny thing here. Is Warren wasn't available to do this recording, so that's actually me doing Candy's lines.
Oh, yeah, that's right. It was you did a temp recording that we were going to later
but
replace.
We never got to.
Yeah, I don't think anybody's going to be able to tell the difference.
It's kind of funny.
Well, now they can.
All right, well, now they
could
can.
You know, Warren is normally here for these commentaries, and he's not. Could you do his role now here, too?
Yeah.
I was going to point out that he's not available for this commentary either. And we should give him the occasional shout-out.
Warren Graff, by the way, one of our writers, also the voice of Handy and Toothy, in case you're keeping score at home.
Who, as he's listening to this right now, is crying. In the future. Yeah.
In the
from
future.
Now.
Wow, that's blowing my mind.
Just wait. Wait for
wait
it.
Wait for it. This is awesome. We kind of agree that Mime's vehicle would just be a unicycle wherever, you know, he had to go. And whenever he was on it, he has to juggle ball.
The faster he juggles, the faster he goes.
That's kind of how he drives.
Some kind of weird unicycle power plan.
It doesn't make any sense, but for some reason it cracks us up. So you'll see in this episode and in other episodes, you'll see him going around just juggling those balls. It's just how he does it. Ooh. This was a gag added by Lippy, knocking with using the balls.
Brilliant.
You know, it's funny. I've been so busy talking to you guys that I've lost the narrative here.
Narrative? There's a narrative? Is that what I signed up for?
Really?
This is a Buster Keaton gag, or was it a...
But it's Buster Keaton.
Yeah. A Red Skelton gag.
Buster Keaton.
I was about
Keaton.
To say Red Skull.
Look him up, kids.
That we thought, hey, it would be funny to trick that.
That was a nice looking death.
Yeah. An homage. But very Buster Keaton handsome. Didn't die.
No. Not from that, anyways.
No.
He did
true.
Die. Now.
He did die, but not from that. He was a great, though.
A classic.
The guys at Fat Cat are really good with the effects animation.
Absolutely.
And they're good with all the animation, but the effects really.
It's Fat Cat with a K.
With a K.
Those crazy Canadians. What will they
think
of next?
Canadians with a K.
Yeah.
Actually.
Hey, Pup's not dead.
He looks weird bald.
That's Ellen Connell doing the voice of Cub.
It is. Who's also the voice of Giggles and Petunia.
And just an all-around nice person.
And there's Mime.
Oh, there was
never
Mime.
Look back. Never look back.
This is a great little, like, almost crushed him.
It's ironic.
It is ironic. If you don't know that word, you can probably Wikipedia it.
Or listen to that song by Alanis Morrison. Morissette.
Always cracks me up. Stupid.
Bloody stool. He should see a doctor.
Hey, we forgot to kill Lumpy.
Don't. Ah, Mime Defy.
This is the ultimate Mime episode.
I like this episode, too.
All Mime all the time.
All Mime all the time. We had this idea that we wanted to put Mime in all these jobs that he would be ill-equipped for.
Which are all jobs, pretty much.
Well, not as much. All jobs that would require him to speak.
Yeah. Because Lumpy is probably more inappropriate for most jobs than Mime would be.
And of course, like we were talking about earlier, Mime's all about the unicycle.
Yeah.
And who keeps moths in their pockets?
It's a cartoon way of showing that you're broke. It's either that or a big barrel that he wears.
Well, he's paying rent on this expensive house.
And here's this great gag where... I love that Mime's house is this little tent, but it's this enormous room that's full of nothing but his imaginary appliances and furniture.
Well, it interestingly brings up Mime's age because he needs reading glasses. So is Mime over 40?
He only needs joke reading glasses.
Ah.
We wanted to do a whole episode about Russell's fish shack.
Oh, yeah, Russell's fish shack. Could never kind of figure it out, but...
There's still season two.
There's still
three.
Yeah. Maybe.
Four. Oh, but all the characters died. We can't do anymore.
Oh. We'll come up with new ones.
Too bad that tree in the back didn't break.
This is fun. Boarded once again by Ted Pratt.
Yeah.
You know, he can eat no fat.
The versatile.
I love the fact that Mime's invisible furniture can make sound effects. Oh, this is a good one.
I could be a lifeguard.
Once again, terrific music by Jerome Rawson.
The fake binoculars.
Fake binoculars, yeah.
One of the harder props we had to build.
This is a funny gag. The whole Baywatch slow motion moment. And then Petunia just walks in and you reveal that that he's just doing it.
You have no idea how difficult that special effect was to achieve.
What, slow motion?
Yeah, with the regular motion in it.
Was it actually a special effect?
No, it's just animation like everything else. I was being facetious.
Ah.
Ah, facetious. Another word to Wikipedia.
You know, next time I'm going to do this commentary as a Happy Tree Friend.
Be brilliant.
I wouldn't have to think of anything to say.
Just how to say it.
Well, that job didn't work. I'm cleaning the window.
You know, you got to say, even though he's terrible at these jobs, he's got a really good attitude.
Generally got a big smile.
They all do.
See how happy he is?
Here's Disco going to a salon.
I like how kind of pissed Disco is just about things in general.
He's crying on the inside.
Yeah.
Won't get fooled again.
Shame on me.
Oh! He dies.
In your face, Disco Bear. That's a little bit of a Spider-Man No More homage.
Yeah.
Very small.
Yeah, very small.
I've noticed that.
Although there's a bigger
thought.
Homage here with Lumpy.
Yeah.
I mean,
you mean the ringmaster at the circus?
Yes.
Ooh,
the ringmaster
said too
at
much.
The circus.
Okay. I've said too much.
Look it up, kids.
Wikipedia. Wonder if we can get paid by Wikipedia for all the times we.
If we say it 100 more times.
All right. Depends on how many clicks we can give them on this.
This is great, that little Lumpy, stupid performing.
I like the fact that one of them is too chicken to do it and goes around.
Not
too
chicken, duck.
He's too duck. He ducks the responsibility.
Whoa, now we're rolling.
Here's a Cro-Marmot doing the crazy.
Cro-Marmot can do anything.
Off screen.
Off screen. That's elephant shit.
No, it's mud.
Oh, that's right.
In case you don't understand this, Lumpy is asking Mime to put in
to tell Toothy
to put in two scoops. And then,
but of course, since Mime doesn't talk,
Toothy doesn't understand because he's Toothy.
He thinks he means two barrels.
You know, we should actually probably play that explanation over the actual the show.
Have a live action pop up. Hello.
In case you find
Toothy asking for money, but getting a shovel instead. Lumpy's a mean taskmaster.
Ah, oh, Cuddles.
Evil Knievel Cuddles. Oh! Oh, Toothy.
That is one of the most peculiar deaths on all of Happy Tree Friends.
It's very cartoony.
Spin art!
Oh.
Oh, it's a good thing I caught this.
That would
out
really
of the
hurt.
Woods now.
Yeah.
Phew. Hang on for dear life. Here's another worst job for the worst characters. Flaky is a high high rope.
Right, and high, now the,
what do you call
tightrope
walker?
Tightrope
walker.
The question is, what wrecks what?
Oh!
It turns out the intestine was stronger than the porcupine.
Especially when you stretch it out. Here's where we reveal the
bloodthirsty ducks.
Carnivorous ducks.
In a cage that doesn't really do much.
Exactly. That's the best part.
Yeah, it keeps their prey from escaping.
I love the death ducks.
I love mole clapping.
Mole clapping. That was awesome. This is the best show ever.
Yeah, I've never seen this. That's really funny.
It's genuine laughter.
Oh, I love this. Commentary from someone who's never seen the show. He did write it, though.
Yeah, I mean, I wrote it. I kind of knew
what was
going to happen.
Next time we'll just have fans come in here and do commentary for
us. We should do that. We should actually have some kind of contest.
I remember we had to redo that shot there at the end, Dave, remember? Because the animators at Fat Cat were like, oh, how are we going to get Crow Marmot out that door? It's so tiny. We were like, oh, logistics.
Okay, Blaster in the Past, based on the original episode.
Oh, it's been fun knowing you.
Yeah.
For those fans who go way back, you'll recognize this.
This came about because one day Ken Pontac came in and he was like, oh my God, I just saw this crazy movie.
Primer,
which if you guys haven't seen, you guys should, because it'll totally blow your mind. But after that, we all watched it and we were like, oh man, that movie was crazy. We got to do a time travel episode.
And it took Mark Zaslav to finally crack that.
Oh, yeah, we spent weeks.
We batted this around. Now, I think the only constant that we knew was it was Sniffles. He was building a time machine.
Out of a washing machine.
And that it was based on the original event, and somehow, well, I don't want to give too much away.
Well, at this point, they've probably already seen it.
That's true.
It takes somebody who's hardcore to watch the commentary before they watch the show.
I love you for doing that, whoever you are.
Yeah, if you guys are listening to this, you get a purple heart.
Yeah, really. You know, I actually did do that on a movie that I won't mention because it's the whole thing is too politically charged, but I basically just wanted to hear the director bitch about how badly he'd failed.
Wow.
Yes.
Oh. So anyways, to continue the story.
Yes. Mark Zaslav, being smarter than Ken Warren and I
put together.
was able to crack the nut in about a week.
I'm sure it's not the first time travel story he's done.
It all worked out.
All the plants and the callbacks, and it's pretty crazy, but he cracked it, man. It came out great.
It just makes me think of all those time travel stories where they spend endless time of exposition explaining words.
It was so hard to just try to keep everything straight.
Without saying anything.
Yeah, I'm sure we missed something.
Oh, this is perfectly clear to everybody.
Was this a Greg Garcia board?
Yes. Greg boarded this, I'm pretty darn sure.
Originally, we were going to have him spin around in there and time machine.
Come out dizzy.
That got too crazy because we needed some shots of him actually looking out, so.
Well, after a while, we just use the shorthand. Yeah. We don't even show the time machine.
Yeah. Brilliant! I could have sworn there was something.
I knew there was. He's all happy about it.
Here's the next piece of the puzzle.
This is the most unlikely way to die, I think, in a Happy Tree Friends episode. Like, how is this going to kill him?
Like this.
Oh.
It came out great, though.
Yeah, I remember you drew that picture on the whiteboard, and I took a picture of it to give to Greg to make sure he got it right. It's hard to describe that in writing.
Yeah, don't try that at home or on the playground.
Yeah, this is the whole thing about like this is the best intentions. What's that cliche?
The road to hell is paved with good intentions.
So here's Sniffles always trying to make it, you know, fix everything, and he just makes it worse. Super greased.
However, this whole reveal coming up is a brilliant, brilliant move, I think, because of the aspect of Spin Fun Knowing You that I think everybody questions. Which is, like, where did the jumbo jet come from?
We explain it all! It's all revealed here.
It's a love letter to the fans.
It is. It's like, hey, it's a jumbo jet!
I'm safe.
Well, hopefully at this point, when you're watching this the first time, you haven't put it together yet.
Yeah, you might not, because you haven't seen the merry-go-round yet.
I want to get that Fight Club moment at the end where you're like, what?
Yeah.
Especially if you're hardcore. And if you're listening to this, you probably are hardcore. Give yourself another Purple Heart.
If you are listening to this, write in and tell us at what point the Fight Club moment came for you.
This is great. In fact, that guy did a great job animating that.
Yeah, they really got into the broken spine animation on this particular show.
We wanted to do an episode all about...
There's a Croa.
Yeah.
Croa sniffle.
Nice. The unibrow.
And the machine, the little hint there that when the machine falls on the little dinosaur, just a little hint. And we wanted to show that in the past, that Anteater and Ant lived harmoniously together until this moment.
Hey, that's a good idea.
He's like, hey, that's pretty good.
I love the proto pencils in his pocket protector.
the wooden glasses.
Yeah, the wooden glasses. Yeah, in his original design, he didn't have the glasses, but we were like, we gotta put the glasses on him, man. It's Sniffles.
This really happens.
Oh, yeah.
If you go over the bar too hard.
You turn inside out, really, is what happened. She would have been inside out by then.
Like the pixelated.
Yeah, it's total pixels.
The pixelated wood chips. It's too hot for TV. That's why we had to pixelate it.
So there's no park left.
Like, hey, I could have sworn the park was right here, but then Lumpy finds in the bushes.
And it's the
And here's the setup.
Fun setup. This is where it all began.
It is.
This simple story.
This part was easy to write.
Yeah, we could go home and when it came to this part, we're like, yeah, we'll just go home. The fat cat guy has lovingly recreated the...
All new animation.
All new animation. Because I think, correct me if I'm wrong, Dave, for legal reasons, we could use our own Spin Fun episode. In this.
And for technical reasons, because originally it was done at like 8 frames a second.
Yeah, we had to make sure that it all worked together and that the backgrounds were seamless and stuff, so. But they did a great job.
We just wanted to have those fat cats do it.
Yeah, here it is, but do it again. We're mean.
And here's where it all comes together. Ah, he sees the milk.
This is a great moment.
So if you go back and notice that the blood's there.
Which I didn't notice.
Explains it all. Exactly.
There you go.
That's the Fight Club moment.
And I wrote it. Actually, no, Zaslav wrote it.
Zaslav wrote it.
He did write it. That's a good one. Just brilliantly conceived. Shoes at a mouth.
I don't even remember.
It's an all nutty show this time.
Oh, yes.
We wanted to do, we were trying to give each character kind of their own episode. And this was one for Nutty.
Yeah, a lot of the characters we had to give new personality traits to, but Nutty has always had his personality
really strong.
Trait.
Still, I mean, really have elaborated on how he gets up in the morning, though no alarm clock in his case.
No.
Yeah.
Well, we don't know if it's even morning.
It's true.
He just woke up from his
binge. At some point.
Brushing his teeth and gargling with soda. Yeah. We should do a dentist episode again with Nutty. Because it's got to be rank in there, man.
Yeah, we should have a scratch and sniff on...
This is great. Instead of clothes, we have a candy in his drawers. And
it's like, oh, that's right. He wasn't wearing the candy.
He treats it as clothes.
And it's all messy, too. Yeah. He doesn't fold his candy.
No, he doesn't.
He's a consummate bachelor.
He's a messy guy.
I'm really glad because in Concrete Solution, we showed his place, and it was totally clean, and that always bugged me. It wouldn't be neat at all. It would be totally messy.
This is great. He's making coffee out of jelly beans. That's got to be disgusting.
But not sweet enough.
Nope. Went straight for it. It's all right. Needs more sugar.
A little more sugar.
But what the?
Spit take. Any excuse.
Never go wrong with a spit take. He goes to this candy supermarket.
Candy supermarket.
The only place he shops.
I'm surprised he's not running this.
It's like the marshmallows are like produce there.
Yeah, I love it. You gotta squeeze
it. He's grazing. The place is probably open just because of him. Yeah. He supports it entirely.
They've saved his life a million times without him knowing.
Taking all the stuff from the shelves. Giant jawbreaker.
A jawbreaker. Now, what can you do with a jawbreaker? He's excited. The fat cat guys gave extra special love to his eye.
Yeah.
His googly eye.
Googly eye.
Oh!
Nice.
There goes his jaw.
I love this x-ray with the candy sucker on it. Lumpy is actually a competent surgeon in this case.
Well, so far.
Yeah, the day is young.
Here's Nutty not being able to eat it. So, of course, he's going to bypass.
That would really hurt.
This never works, by the way. It's like, just the screwdriver is not intended for this.
Oh, good time.
Wonderful sound effect there by Jim Lively.
Yeah. Gotta screw it in because you can't trust him.
Again, fantastic sound effect of a cordless drill running a high load.
Yes.
It's the full-on headgear. He's hungry, so Lumpy's gonna puree him some apple so he can drink it.
Did you guys ever have to wear braces in school?
I did.
Like the big headgear?
No, never.
I did at night.
The big wraparound.
Yeah, luckily I only had to wear it at night. But I had the braces. And my teeth are still messed up.
Not as bad as now.
Oh! Ow! You're just waiting eye surgery.
That can't be sterile.
Somebody else started the surgery, but you have to finish it now, Lumpy.
Lumpy probably started it.
Yeah, he wanted to go golfing. Now he's bummed out.
And here's Nutty taking tentative sip of apple and finding it totally disgusting.
Oh, it's good for you.
Yeah. Exactly. He's like, hey, I got an idea. This'll work.
Happy Tree Friends never put a top on their blender, ever.
No, they don't sell them in their land.
And here it comes, the switcheroo. This is a great gag.
Yeah, this is the best gag in the show.
It is. Let's look quite right.
It's like, it's... and the music.
Oh, Lumpy.
See, I'm telling you, the hat on a hat works.
It does work. Here's Nutty taking the whole thing.
He just steals the patient.
Now, when Lippy did Nutty with the mouth covered, how did he do it? Did he have his... just do it through clenched teeth?
Yeah, he just pretty much did it through clenched teeth.
He was acting.
Acting.
How did he do it? I punched him in the jaw and...
We wired it shut.
Yeah.
A lovely cameo by Mime there.
A quick cameo.
Little Streets of San Francisco moment.
Let's represent for the town, man.
Yeah, man.
Here's Nutty falling behind, so he has to lighten his load, and he starts chucking all this stuff.
Shakes that can of soda up real good.
Don't do it, Disco.
I love how short the cameos are for the characters in this.
Boom, dead.
Oh!
And dead.
Well, catch it up. And of course, they end up in the junkyard.
Fine bit of Z-axis animation there by our friends at Fat Cat. Oh.
This can't be good.
This is bad. Another great sound effect.
Indeed. There it is!
See, this is the ultimate classic cartoon prop. It's a giant junkyard magnet.
Yeah.
There's just nothing better than that.
Rips it right off.
Uh-oh. And you know, magnets like that have timing.
Yeah, they do.
Selective.
They're actors.
The It's kind of funny too. Like the only thing keeping him from utterly getting smushed is the jawbreaker.
Oh. That's humorous.
White stuff.
Get it?
And vitreous.
Who boarded that? This is a Tom Price, wasn't it?
I think it was Tom Price.
I think it was Tom Price. Another episode I've never seen before, as was the last
one. Welcome.
Yeah,
this is exciting.
I've only seen like two of these.
Ted Pratt.
Yeah.
So you guys, you're getting the very first reactions of Ken Pontac.
That's yeah, my laughter is genuine. And unless I laugh
or
like
scowl.
This. That won't be real.
This newspaper's falling. Of course, Lumpy's driving it. It's incompetent.
The Acorn World's
night. The Daily Bugle.
Yeah, here's my favorite aspect of this show is Splendid Secret
Splendid
Identity.
Splendid Secret Identity.
He still wears his mask. He fools everybody,
though. The
first
time we've seen his alter ego.
Yeah.
This is a great little bit of business. I love this. Not having Moloch getting the water.
Yeah, must be empty.
Must be empty. But it doesn't feel all the water dropping on.
He couldn't drink it anyway with his sweater up around his mouth.
It's true. Here's the fake out. Ah!
Sniffles would be a great photographer.
But no, I'm Lumpy.
If you can change a
we
bottle.
We should have given him the J. Jonah Jameson Hitler mustache, man.
That would have been funny.
Totally missed out on that. Great wipe here. That's an awesome wipe.
Yeah, elevator wipe.
Ted
yes.
Pratt.
Ted also is the master of signage.
Simple and sweet. Here's a setup for
yeah. How often do you see a happy tree friend with a baguette?
Exactly.
The universal symbol of groceries.
I love Cro-Marma's hat there. Huh? Why do I get it stuck with this idiot? I like that Mole just puts that on over him.
Over him. Yeah. Well, he doesn't need it.
Smoke setting off the sprinklers and short-circuiting the door. This is where all goes wrong. This is a great wind-up camera.
I want a gumball machine like that.
Yeah, really.
No money required.
You just need a light bulb.
Exactly. And here's where we find out that, the door is closed.
Poor Nutty. Daddy.
See, here we go again. Yeah. Lime with his juggling balls. Trouble! Mm-hmm. Classic. It's gonna change, but wait! Oh, Chroma perfectly filled in there.
How do you get in there and how do you close the door?
Magic, my friends, magic. Oh!
A little rear window homage there.
By the skin of his teeth, literally.
He's really.
But wait!
I don't remember that being there before. It was hidden by the other one.
I think that's a great gag. Changing in the phone booth and Cubs there so he couldn't change. A little bit of skin coming out.
Oh gosh, I totally forgot about this bit.
There you go. Yeah. Once again, the mole switch over here.
It's sort of like film.
Skin film.
It's skin film. It's a skin film. Mm-hmm. Gonna change in it. Oh, gross. I like that Splendid's got a queasy stomach.
He's seen worse.
Yeah. Oh, he's vomited up huge amounts in the past.
Oh, I remember. Oh, this is a great scene.
Oh, yeah.
Screams like a girl. David Wynn is the voice of Splendid and the voice of Lumpy. Great job there. Screaming like a girl.
Hard working voice actor.
He is a hard
worker.
He is. I remember having a discussion here with Ted Pratt about his upper jaw coming out like that because he wouldn't. but, you know, it's a cartoon and it's funny, so.
A lot of these things probably wouldn't happen.
Yes, that's
hopefully
true.
Hopefully not.
Yeah.
Splendid putting on the afterburners, trying to catch him in time. Oh, too late.
Ah, nice little bounces of all the organs and stuff.
Oh, well.
I'm still not quite clear on the physics here.
She's attached to it.
She's holding on really hard.
Fixing it.
Don't.
Oh well. And there's the setup for the payoff for Giggles' setup. Like the shaky camera.
That's what that baguette was for.
Absolutely.
Gotcha!
Toothy in the camera shack.
I love that car's just crashed in. Sonic boom there.
This is exciting.
Riveting.
There's speechless.
Dead. From all the water.
Disco Bear always dies in his poses.
He's so powerful, yet very vulnerable to Flash.
Flash animation.
Yeah.
And he can be blinded too, you know.
Absolutely.
Blinded by the light.
Exactly. I love this little bit of rips the door open.
Lumpy.
His secret identity.
A little throwaway.
The second time
two episodes
he gets
in a row, yeah. Frozen and bashed in a little bit. Oh, he's sad.
This is really nice.
Okay.
All the pictures that Mole took. Terrible pictures.
Not bad for Mole, though.
Exactly. I guess he got something in the cap.
Is that a can of dust off or what?
I don't know. This is old school.
It is. Hey, his identity. Oh! But now it's exposed. No one will ever know. No one will be the wiser. Status quo, back to normal.
The famous Idol show.
The Idol.
This so, one. Oh, go on.
Go ahead, go ahead.
I just remember we came up with this one really fast. We actually had gotten ahead of schedule for our script a week. Came up with the idea of this on a Friday. Pretty much beat it out. So we went in Monday all fat and sassy, knowing we had a show we were going to write. So we were actually able to take a little extra time to make this one, I think, a little funnier.
Yeah, I think a lot of the Idol shows, you know, were so random about just about, like, it just causing everything to go wrong. And this one has that extra twist to it.
It kind of explains, well, this one also kind of explains where the Idol comes from.
The Idol origin show.
A little bit of the Idol origin.
This happens a lot in Happy Tree Friends. You look at something, a picture of something, the thing is right in backup.
Yeah.
It's like, we were trying to get here, and now we're here.
Fun reveal. There it is. The Idol.
Oh, pretty.
Shouldn't have picked it up.
Don't
shouldn't have gotten near it, because it's going to rain dead monkeys.
Where are the dead monkeys come from?
The clouds, they're flying monkeys.
And here's one of the best characters ever.
The crack.
The crack.
Now, how many anthropomorphic cracks are there? I think this might be the first and last.
It's gotta be, man.
Yeah.
It's so good. Actually, yeah, we wrote this whole episode around the crack, pretty much.
Yeah.
Once we
came up with the crack.
Came up with the crack.
Did it? That's the first time you realize, oh, it's got a mind of its own.
Oh, yeah, it's more than just a regular crack.
That's my dog whistle.
It's Crack Plus.
Yeah, that's the sound effect there is of Ken's little cute dog, who also did all the sound effects for another dog show that we did. Called Dog on It.
Oh. Crazy carnivorous plant. Here comes the crack.
Oh, that crack.
Oh yeah, here's where the crack has to make up its mind.
Oh, I love this gag. Where it stops. And then looks left, looks right. Where is he? And the classic, like, throwing the rock. There he is!
After him.
That works so well.
And then falling off the cliff. You'll hear a faint there in the background. Listen for it.
Form dissolve. That's very fancy.
by Tom Price.
Tom Price is a fancy guy.
He is.
He's ripped, too.
The crack is back. Barely escapes and it falls in the water.
Nothing left to crack.
I love that it falls in the water. And again, if you strain to hear, you'll hear it kind of...
Show's got a lot of wacky wipes in it.
It does.
Yes, oh, it's everything.
Here's how
just
the idol
fine.
Causes trouble some more. Russell should be the captain.
This is his day job.
Maybe it's on their own rotation. Dope.
Oh!
That can't be good.
But it's funny.
Yeah.
And it's a great setup
for water skiing
with your guts.
Your guts.
See, this is the totally good randomness of... Coral. That looks like it makes sense. Coral. Oh, more coral. And then there's a flaming hoop. It's like, what the...
Who put that there?
Out of nowhere.
Where there's coral, there's often a flaming hoop.
It's funny with Lumpy here.
He's not wearing
any
pants.
He never wears pants. It's commando style. What? It's still headed for it.
Hunla, what the?
Stupid Lumpy.
I like this little moment where they're just like...
Where they're just laughing at their own silliness.
Oh,
but
there
was a real iceberg.
Oh. That was a David Ichioka gag.
It is.
Yeah, they're pushing through the antlers.
This came out great, too.
Yeah.
The little umbrella in the eye. Pull it up. Boat sinks.
Very short-lived.
How we roll in Happy Tree Friends.
Yeah.
Huh? What the? How did I sleep through all that?
Really? How did I survive all that? Hey, what happened to my backpack?
Why am I all scratched?
From the previous.
Oh, that's right.
Here's really where the crack pays off.
Yeah, this is pretty much why the whole episode is written, right? This next gag coming up.
Where we got the other taxi coming up.
It's like we like this joke so much. We're gonna write a whole 7-minute show based on it.
The crack followed him. The fat guy guys added the crack tipping the cab.
The crack tipping the cab is really great.
That's awesome.
Which I thought was a nice touch too.
I'm liking the way the fat cat guys are designing a lot of these backgrounds now too. With perspective be damned type of
stylized.
Exactly. Hey, wait, no.
All that for nothing because the crack's on.
That's a crack.
It's a crack.
I can go
underdoors. Should have really thought this through. Of course, what's underneath the crack? Hot lava.
Yeah. That's where you build your museum.
Naturally.
Nice effects animation.
Yeah.
And here's the crack crawling up. It's gonna get him. It's gonna finally get him, but wait.
Right. Listen, now short attention span sniffles. Hey, everything's okay now.
Yeah. But wait. Oh, it did get him.
It got him. It cracked him.
Oh, sniffles. It's a little display.
Yes. And here it is, one of the only times ever that the show does not end in an iris out.
But a crack.
Exactly.
The crack got you. It's in your TV, run! Hi! Don't take the taxi, whatever you do.
Okay, now this is gonna be the weirdest show there is.
This was also a Zaslav.
Was Mark Zaslav's script?
I think so.
Yes.
Well, it was a combination.
I think he was brought on to like fix something.
Yeah,
right?
To fix it exactly.
Actually, I'm pretty sure I was homesick for most of this, and I had to talk to you guys over the phone.
Yeah.
That was horrible.
We had to talk to your phlegm.
Oh, yeah.
Phlegmy. And Elaine.
Storyboarder Elaine Hultgren. Yeah.
Episode.
who couldn't make it to our rap party, but Greg Garcia brought a picture of her face on a stick in lieu of her
coming. Anything, anything on a stick is sold.
Yeah. Butter on a stick.
Sold. I'm buying. Where do I line up?
Line points to the left, buddy.
I love Lumpy's laugh here.
He's easily amused.
He never sounds stupider.
No, I beg to differ, but... He can always sound stupider. The whole concept of this house kind of came about from, if you guys have ever been to, is it in Sunnyvale?
San Jose, the Winchester Mystery House.
The Winchester Mystery House. It's definitely a place to check out. It's, widow of, I can't remember, Mr. Winchester,
Mr. Winchester.
From the Winchester Rifle.
From the Winchester Rifle, was told that, all the ghosts of all the people that her husband's guns killed would haunt her forever unless she built this crazy house.
And she was crazy enough to believe it. Yeah. And rich enough to build the house.
So if you've ever been to this house, it's really nuts. There's doors that don't lead to anywhere, staircases that don't go anywhere, and all to confuse the ghosts, apparently. So that's just a great...
It's a hobby.
Yeah, it's a living. There's a lot of setup for a lot of the gags that's going to happen later. It's a classic walking down some imaginary stairs.
And here's that laugh again.
He is an idiot man-child.
Yes. I have to take a little bit of credit for this because I recorded this. That sound, it's my shredder at home.
Is it really?
Destroying a CD. Yeah.
What CD did you destroy for that?
Oh, it was just a bunch of DVDs of some TV show called Happy Tree Friends.
Yeah. They're worthless.
Hey, the house is built. It's Habitat for Humanity.
And it looks all right in this picture. But
what
wait.
What?
But we followed the specs. What could go wrong?
Who designed this? Nice bird.
Yes.
And here's some more Lumpy in the sandwich.
As long as it's a sandwich, it's okay with Lumpy.
I believe that our composer, Jerome, noticed that there was no sandwich in that original shot.
Yeah, well, he did.
After our final show was delivered.
We had to add it
we
in.
We had to add it in.
You know where I thought you were going with that? I thought you were going to say that we had so many sandwich moments that Jerome has written a sandwich theme.
Oh, no, maybe he has.
That was Mole, by the way, finding the actual exit because that they were all looking for. And of course, since he's blind, disregards it.
Yeah, this is one of the weird aspects is how gravity just shifted 90 degrees.
It's a weird house, dude.
It is.
Just got to go with it.
It's like a mystery spot.
That was funny.
Lumpy thinking mime fell downstairs. And he really did. Who put stairs there? Here we're reinforcing Petunia's OCD again. Her being a neat freak. Overreacting at this little piece of sludge.
She just seems to have this cleaning stuff everywhere.
I like that image.
Yeah, an astute viewer will notice that sometimes she's on the right banister and sometimes she's on the left banister.
It's a crazy house!
Yeah. That's probably why Lumpy's antlers keep changing place, too.
Oh,
that's painful.
This actually, you should take credit for that, Dave.
That's one of the cringe moments.
Dave
yeah.
added that gag.
Drew it out.
Drew it
you.
Himself. It was a fun little gag, too. I finally got it open. But wait.
Oh,
there's another door.
David, by any chance, do you still have the artwork that you created for that?
I think it's scanned in on the network somewhere, yeah.
It's on the boards in this very DVD. You'll see it.
Ah, good. Yeah, check out our bonus features.
Sounds dirty.
Isn't this one of the bonus features?
No, this is a show.
No, us talking.
Oh, yeah, right. Check out more of our bonus features.
Yeah, just listen to this again. Forget those other bonus features. That's not as cool.
I love that shot.
Yeah,
a little multi-plane action.
Yeah.
Oh!
Ah, the Murphy bed death. When will they learn?
Just bringing all the classics out. the Dutch Doors, the Murphy Bear.
Double eyes, twice in this show.
Four eyes!
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. The electric shower.
Electric shower.
That's quite the callback.
Yeah.
There we go.
It's a big one.
You know, in a feature, a callback 4 minutes ago is nothing.
Well, I can't wait to do the feature.
Yeah, watch out for the Happy Tree Friends feature.
Open that door!
You know, he's a pretty tough guy.
He is.
He's got that helmet. It's a cheat. It's a crutch.
Crutches are good if you have a broken leg. Here's a callback coming up.
Big callback. That's supposed to explain everything.
Yeah, duh.
And another callback.
Oh. Eye through eye through eye.
It's pretty deep.
Oh, yeah, that cuddle's being planed into a board at the beginning of the show callback. Very tough.
It's giant.
You gotta watch the show.
I love this. And this music, Jerome, outdid himself with this country theme.
Sweet.
This is, I think, unanimously one of our favorite episodes. We struggled a little bit at the beginning of this, yes. And then Warren Graff came up with this idea that Lumpy has this giant corn that he's been raising for the fair.
That cracked the story. From that moment on, in other shows, when we were stuck, we'd say, well, where's our giant corn moment?
Where's our giant corn?
This just all came together. Was great. It at that moment that they decided that he loved the giant corn and it was his son?
It pretty much all fell together. I think we were already talking that Lumpy loved his corn, but it wasn't giant.
It became giant. And I love that this was a story brought by Ted Pratt. But the design of this show, in particular, is just really nice. Came out great.
Yeah, I think this is because he got that Cintiq tablet.
Probably.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, this is a great little moment with the
pan
of the corn.
This is so sweet.
It was fun coming up with the corn moments.
Moments of corn.
My wife watched this and was going, "Oh, that's so nice. He loves his corn."
So do the crows.
Can't get enough of it. Big band, dude. Whenever Lumpy thinks like that, you know it's trouble.
Yeah, the basic idea is not bad. It's what he does with it.
Exactly.
You see, that's another great cartoon conceit, is the instant delivery.
Yeah.
It's right out of Roadrunner.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah.
I like the scarecrow that looks like him.
There's that musical theme again. This makes me happy to hear it.
And speaking of your Roadrunner moments.
Exactly.
A classic.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Warner Brothers.
What? A fake out. Because he's not hurt by
that. Cartoon that keeps on giving.
Yeah.
It is a fake out. Until there.
the electric wood.
Whoa. Keep it in your pants, buddy.
Sorry, I really like this episode.
Damn you, crow!
He hates that crow.
Yeah.
See, this is what hatred will get you.
Yeah.
That's why we don't have any hatred.
Right.
Don't be a hater.
Be a watcher.
It's just more pro-social commentary that we do. This is all about teaching good things.
Well, since parents won't, we have to.
Exactly.
Blind rage.
Yeah. And an axe. And Lumpy. Bad combination.
There's a big homage coming up. Classic.
See if you can figure out which one.
Kids, watch the movie The Shining.
And be mentally scarred forever.
I love that. I love that transition. The axe goes up in the air.
And he's demolishes his home. Here's a great gag here. Aside from the instant delivery, that Lumpy has to walk to his door and open it, even though
and then
there's
it
no
falls
walls.
Apart.
But nobody would probably catch that.
Everybody.
Yeah. Oh, it's funny. It's pretty much there. I like this gag
See?
Too.
Hatred once again.
Yeah, bees hate rocks.
They did a great job animating these bees. They
yeah.
Did.
Yeah. The anticipation
bees,
there.
Bees, yeah. Exactly. The anticipation there is awesome.
I'll jump into the lake. Oh, the wave
nice
is barbed wire here.
This is just horrible.
I wish I'd never delivered that package.
Never wins being a postal service.
Yeah, I was wondering about this. We showed this episode a while ago. And I was wondering if some of these gags were gonna read, but this one totally worked. And this,
I love this.
Got a big laugh. The fact that he uses the board as a blanket.
Oh,
so
it got a big great. Laugh from us when it came up too. We were screaming.
Originally, it was like rubble. I think, and Ted just
it?
Made a board. Yeah,
no, he was going I remember. I remember saying board.
Did you really?
Yeah, yeah.
I always imagined it was rubble. He would just like a blanket.
Lumpy winds.
Ooh, and it's still chilly. That was always a weird
that transition.
Yeah.
Uh-oh. At this point, everybody knows what's going to happen.
Exactly.
Except Lumpy.
Giant corn plus heat equals giant popcorn.
But this gag is great. Turning giggles into a female disco bearer with the popcorn is just, that's just
Are
inspired.
Those sheep in, is that like a sheep go around in the background?
There actually? Is sheep in the background.
I think that's a fat cat thing.
This is pretty fun too.
Yeah.
Whole near miss. Oh. So flaky. Oh.
Oh, nice.
And then hit by
I love
mole.
This.
At least you got it quick.
Nobody yeah. escapes. Oh.
They didn't.
Here's the carnage.
Carnival carnage.
Notice that mole's all the way over to the right, by the way.
Yeah, what happened there?
It's magical.
Oh, now here comes one of the most poignant moments in film.
This makes me cry.
Really?
What Lumpy's going to win the Oscar for. Oh.
Okay, it's not poignant anymore.
Popcorn's good.
Pointless. Mm.
I think next time we do commentary, we should have popcorn.
Okay. Yeah, that would
Is
sound
all you're
great.
Gonna hear.
I think that would be hysterical. What do you say, kids? Write in and let us know.
Petition for more popcorn in your commentary.
That's it for this DVD.
Wow, is that it?
That's it. Dang. It was. I hope you had as much fun as we did watching this. As
we still wanted to hang out.
Yeah.
I want popcorn.
Yeah. You guys got any chips?
Yeah. Ketchup.
Ketchup. Well, thanks for hanging out, and I guess we will see you on the next DVD. If you aren't driven away by this DVD.
Because we can see you through the TV.
Yeah, at this point, you guys are already committed. You might as well get the fourth one, too.
It's the best.
It's got extra episodes on it. So you'll feel like you've gotten something for free.
Extra?
Yeah, there's more on the fourth DVD. 3 extra segments.
Get 2, kids.
Yeah. More playable, come to buy with your friends.
Bye.